Welcome, everyone. I thought I'd start by introducing the speaker today to tell you how I met him. And we were at a small invite-only conference in Oxford, so there was only a couple of people there. And after the first lecture or two, his booming voice came out of the back row in this really thick Australian accent with, you know, a whole lot of questions that were really spot on the money. And then that just continued to happen throughout the next couple of days of the conference. And that booming Australian voice belongs to Mark Febbraio. And the reason I tell that story is because, you know, for all the students in the audience and the PhD students as well, you know, really getting that first postdoc position and, you know, furthering your career in that particular way, asking questions at seminars is a really great way to do it, a really great way to get noticed. It's certainly how I noticed Mark for the first time. And it was really wonderful to have so many questions from the students after last week's seminar, and I really hope that it continues again today. So Professor Mark Febbraio is the head of the Professor of Cell Biology and Division Head in the Signaling and Metabolism Unit at the Baker IDI. He has over 10,000 career citations. His H factor is 61, or probably more than that now. And he's perhaps most famous for the discovery that during exercise, the body can release inflammatory cytokines like interleukin-6. And he's going to tell you a little bit about that and give you some of the basic background to this sort of biology in this lecture. Thanks a lot, Mark.
Thank you for the introduction, and thank you for not divulging some of the other things we did at that conference, which was inappropriate for this lecture. Do we have a pointer? Sorry, my Italian heritage precludes me from being able to talk without my hands. Maybe I can just use this. If you can find a pointer, that'd be great. It's always a pleasure to be at the WEHI, and for someone who sort of works in bridging metabolism with inflammation and the immune system, it really is an honour to be able to come and show you some of our work. Now, I was instructed to make this a very general-like lecture, so there are a few slides that you may think are rather remedial, but in the interest of trying to give you a background on what we do, I thought it necessary. Now, we all know that obesity is quite a problem, and I just alluded to my heritage, and here you see the statue of David, which you know is Michelangelo, and you can then have a look at what men used to look like many years ago. But if Michelangelo lived today, he probably would have sculpted this. Now, even though we chuckle, it's really no laughing matter. These are some CDC data, and this tracks obesity rates in the US. I don't have the Australian data, but you can see here that the increase in this disease, and obesity really is a disease, is alarming. I know many of you work in many different diseases here, cancer, which is on the rise. A lot of you work on autoimmune diseases and inflammatory diseases, but this is an enormous increase in statistics. And if we look at obesity and we look at diabetes rates here, and it's you can just look at the colours and the colour progression, you can see that rates of obesity precede rates of diabetes. And so there's a clear match between the states in the US that become obese and then progress to disease. So there's no doubt that obesity and type 2 diabetes are linked. And in a somewhat biased approach, we think that insulin resistance is a pre-diabetic state, a state which is difficult to diagnose, because if you go to the doctor, you usually a blood sample's taken and you measure glucose. But insulin resistance occurs when you have hyperinsulinemia for a normal glucose level. Now, we still really don't know what causes insulin resistance, but there are a couple of things that we do know, or there's some dogma within the literature. And the one thing we do know is that fat cells become bigger. I mean, that's very clear to everybody. If you want to diagnose an obese person, you only have to look at them. We know that once adipocytes get bigger. They release fatty acids into the circulation. And we know that fat then can get into cells that aren't necessarily equipped to deal with lipids. So if you think of, if you could have a drug, and TZDs were such a drug, that increases fat cell number, you would never get sick. You would never get diabetes because all of the lipid would stay in here rather than these metabolically active cells like liver and skeletal muscle. Because once the lipid gets in, it forms deleterious lipid species such as ceramide and diacylglycerol. And these can act either directly or indirectly on the insulin receptor, which I'll explain regulation of the insulin receptor in a moment. This was kind of known for the past 40 years, but about 20 years ago, and I'll talk about these discoveries, a lab in Harvard made the link between obesity and inflammation, and this has really driven a whole new field of research. And you can see here that these lipid species can activate serine-threonine kinases, such as JNK and IKK, to dysregulate insulin signaling. They can lead to other organelle stress, such as ER stress, or the lipids are thought to act on the toll receptor. We actually believe that this link here is complete nonsense, but I'm not going to get into that today. And finally, or not finally, and penultimately, I mean, the adipose tissue is not just a dumb storage depot for lipid. It releases adipokines, which then can either act directly or indirectly on the insulin receptor signal transduction pathway. And then finally, 10 years ago, and I'll talk about these data, the discovery was made that immune cells accumulate within adipose tissue beds, and this caused an explosion of interest, and this will be the main focus of my talk today. So just to give you a little bit of a biochemistry 101 lesson, when we eat a meal and glucose is in the circulation, glucose is highly toxic and we need to get that out of the circulation and into storage tissues. And so the pancreas, which is a really important organ, releases insulin, and the insulin then acts upon the insulin receptor pathway to phosphorylate the insulin receptor on tyrosine sites and then to activate downstream molecules such as AKT or PKB. And this then will lead to a trafficking sequence, which is not fully understood, hence the remedialness of this pathway. But we do know that GLUT4 within vesicles will then translocate to the plasma membrane and allow for glucose to enter the cell, being released from the blood, to then either be oxidized, stored as glycogen, or in the liver undergo de novo lipogenesis. Now, as I said before, when lipid gets into the cell, this can be disrupted and it can lead to an inflammatory state. So about 20 years ago, chronic inflammation, which is the symptomatic of these states, it's becoming obvious now that it's linked to many, many chronic metabolic diseases: Alzheimer's disease, cancer, depression, heart attacks, and other diseases. And in fact, in 2010, when Science Magazine produced their insights of the decade, they identified obesity-induced inflammation as one of the 10 most insightful discoveries of the decade leading to the new millennium. Oh, sorry, post the new millennium. My apologies. Proves I'm getting old. Now, this was really the harbinger. This study by Gokhan Hotamislegal, when he was working in Bruce Spiegelman's lab in Boston. This was the harbinger. This was really the first study that was paradigm shifting in the field. And I mean, it's based on this observation here that in the fat of Lane 2, which is an obese mouse, that TNF-alpha was elevated. So this was the first indication that obesity was a chronic inflammatory disease. And Gokhan went on to show that in humans, that lean patients don't have this expression of TNF-alpha. And more importantly, when patients underwent weight loss, the TNF-alpha expression within their adipose tissue was vastly reduced. Now, 10 years later, this was a real breakthrough study by Tony Ferranti's lab in Columbia, in New York. And what they showed was that macrophages are abundant in obese adipose tissue. This is diet-induced obesity, so we feed our animals a high-fat diet to induce obesity. And this is a leptin-deficient animal which doesn't have the signal machinery to feel satisfied, so just continues to eat a normal chow diet. And what you can see is these macrophages accumulate around what we think are dead or dying adipocytes in obese states. And what's more, there's a relationship here between body weight in the animals, these are DBDB animals or lean animals or high-fat fed animals, and the expression levels of the macrophage marker CD68. And this is adipocyte size in the animals, and this is the appearance of percent of F480 positive staining cells in flow cytometry. And you can see very clearly a tight correlation there. So the dogma at the moment is this has been prevalent now for over 10 years, is that as adipocytes expand, they then release factors, and one factor being MCIP1, to drag in, to act as a chemotactic signal, to drag in macrophages, to then accumulate, release pro-inflammatory cytokines such as TNF-alpha and IL-1-beta, which then can transduce a signal in a neighbouring adipocyte to activate serine-threonine kinase pathways, JNK and NF-kappa B, to then cause insulin resistance. So this is the dogma, and drug companies have been really aggressively looking at how to target these macrophages. Now, just to show you a bit of data from our own, just to be a little bit self-indulgent here, there are many, many studies, but I'll show you a couple of studies from our group and in collaboration with others. This is a study we did with Andrea Hevener, who's a longtime collaborator at UCLA. This is when she was at UCSD. And what we did is we selectively knocked PPAR gamma out of the hematopoietic system. We did it two ways, either by bone marrow transplant, so we made chimeras, or by a lysine-Cre-flox system. And you can see very clearly that the macrophages become activated. And then whether or not you use a BMT or a lysine-Cre, the animals become glucose intolerant and insulin resistant, both in terms of glucose disposal and the regulation of glucose metabolism in the liver. And when Hayley Nichols was in my lab, we actually performed bone marrow transplant experiments where we knocked out the scavenger receptor CD36. This had no effect on the body weight of the animals, but what it did was it tended to polarise the macrophages to more an M1 phenotype. You can see here that, M2, you can see here that there was a decrease in TNF-alpha and IL-6 and also a decrease in F480 or CCL2 MCIP1 or CCL2 and F480, so decreasing the chemotaxis within the adipose tissue, and you can see there were less F480 positive staining cells. And then when we looked at the insulin signaling transduction pathway in adipocytes, what's important here is we're looking at the phosphorylation of AKT, and it was almost non-responsive to insulin in the wild-type animals fed a high-fat diet, but there was a marked rescue in the animals that had the deletion of CD36 in the hematopoietic compartment. So this is not by no means an exhaustive list, but it just highlights to you a number of papers in the literature which show a concordance between inflammation and insulin resistance. So you can see that if you knock IKK beta out of the hematopoietic compartment, inflammation's reduced, insulin resistance reduced. If you knock out junk, this was work from Michael Caron's lab, you see a decrease in inflammation, insulin resistance, although this was not seen by Roger Davis's lab. I showed you the work by our group where PPAR gamma went the other way, where you knocked it out, inflammation was increased and insulin resistance was increased, and A.J. Chawla's lab showed the same thing at the same time. If you knock TLR4 out, you get this concordance. We did, interestingly, when we did work with IL-10, we didn't see that IL-10 did anything, which was interesting in itself, and I showed you the data from CD36. One thing we have to bear in mind is that, and this will become very important as this talk progresses, is that there are other immune cells within the adipose tissue compartment, for example, eosinophils here, which keep these macrophages polarised to an alternatively activated state. And this will become very important as this progresses. And then as we progress to obesity, these important cells, including Tregs, which are very important for the polarisation to alternative activation, they leave and they're replaced by other more sinister macrophages, which then are polarised towards M2. Now, one of the papers that really gave impetus to targeting macrophages in obesity was this work by Jerry Olefsky's group. And what they did here is they put the CD11C promoter on put the CD11C gene on a diphtheria toxin receptor promoter, and then made transgenic animals, and then injected both the control and the transgenic with human diphtheria toxin, and you can see here that there was a large resolution of these crown-like structures within adipose tissue beds. And of course, when they did the glucose, this is a glucose tolerance test, which basically is a marker of metabolic health. And you can see here that that was before the diphtheria toxin injection. And the high-fat diet is inducing what we call a glucose intolerance as compared to the chow diet, but there's no difference between the transgenic and the control. But of course, after diphtheria toxin is injected, there was an improvement in the transgenic animals, but they reported not in the animals that were transgenic. But if you take a careful look at this rate of area under the curve versus this, it's about half. So in that instance, it seems to suggest that diphtheria toxin is having off targets, even though the animal doesn't express the receptor. And that wasn't covered in this paper, which we think is an important oversight. So drug companies really said, can we prevent macrophage recruitment therapeutically? Now, according to this review that was published just last year, it's simple. And all we need to do is target MCIP1. And if we can target MCIP1, we'll block the migration of macrophages and everything will be Jim Dandy. Now, for the students in or the junior postdocs, never assume anything in science, because this individual, who I don't know, but clearly there was a little bit of a leap in logic here, because these are data from a CCL2 knockout mouse, and this mouse actually has no phenotype. So by targeting MCIP1, it doesn't prevent macrophage recruitment to adipose tissue beds. In fact, another group saw the opposite, that by making an MCIP1 knockout mouse, these animals, they did two different experiments, which I won't get into, but it was very clear in their study too that knocking out the chemotactic signal MCIP1 exacerbated the inflammation. So it's really important to read the literature and not accept dogma when it comes to these things. And one of the reasons why things may not jive in simple terms is because the immunological milieu within the adipose tissue bed is far more complex than just blocking macrophages, as shown here in this review by Diane Mathis from the Joslin. And you can see here that there's a balance which gets tipped one way or the other in obesity. So the challenge is to try and target all of these things, which may be utopia. Now, how did I get into all of this? Well, I unfortunately decided to study probably the most complex of the cytokines you can get. And just, I really like to use this as a little bit of a lesson here. So we think of cytokines as the good, bad and the ugly. And in metabolism, well, I better talk into this, the first adipokine was adipsin. And then Phil Shearer and Flyer discovered these good cytokines. These are bad cytokines. But IL-6 is the ugly cytokine, all right? And those of you who study it, enough of that nonsense, those of you who study it will realise that it's a very, very complex, complicated cytokine. And in inflammation and cancer, most people think that IL-6 is a really bad thing. And there are several lines of data, and Tisa's in the audience here, I think, and others who look at IL-6 in cancer. And this is Michael Caron's work showing that hepatocellular carcinoma, the gender bias towards men getting HCC is because, at least in mice, if you inject the mice with diethyl nitrosamine and track IL-6, IL-6 goes up much more in male mice, and then if you study IL-6 knockout mice and inject DEN, they don't get as many cancers. If you follow this up with superimposing a high-fat diet, you can see that if you are male, if you are obese, and if you are predisposed to making a lot of IL-6 and you happen to get a carcinogen that's going to induce liver cancer, you're in a bit of strife. And what Michael was able to show here was that this was mediated by STAT3. So STAT3 is thought to be very bad for cancer prognosis, although there are data to suggest, for example, an absence of STAT3 is very bad for prostate cancer, for example. So it's very complex. And of course, a lot of you work in arthritis, and this is 10 countries now are using Actemra to treat RA. And it's very effective, I think. I'm not a rheumatologist, but I believe it's very effective for the treatment of RA. But if you look at the data carefully, it has some pretty significant side effects. And I was actually talking to my cousin yesterday, who happens to be a rheumatologist, and I said, how many of your patients on Actemra get hypercholesterolemia? And she said, all of them. And you can see here that in the clinical trial, there was an increase in BMI, body weight and cholesterol. In the follow-up study, the same thing was seen, to points where you'd want to then put them on a statin. So it's really a double-edged sword. You can treat the RA, but you're going to induce hypercholesterolemia and metabolic dysregulation. And then if we look at the work from the IL-6 knockout mouse, you can see that an absence of IL-6 is actually going to be fairly bad for metabolic homeostasis. This was the first paper published in this area by Jan Olaf Jonsson's group, and you can very easily see that this animal gets obese. And then Vance Matthews, when he was in my lab, we looked at this mouse a little bit more carefully, and you could see that it increases its fat mass, no change in its lean mass, that it increases adipocyte size, gets insulin resistant, and the insulin signaling transduction pathway is altered in the liver. So you have a conundrum here where if you block IL-6, it's going to be good. That's why it's an ugly cytokine. If you block it, it's going to be good for classic inflammatory diseases, but maybe not for chronic low-grade inflammation, which makes it very challenging. And the reason why IL-6 has these positive effects is because it's almost an insulin mimetic in translocating GLUT4 to the membrane. Remember I showed you that figure of how we translocate GLUT4 to the membrane and allow glucose in? Well, this is work we did in collaboration with David James at the Garvan, and this is an HA-tag GLUT4 construct in muscle cells, and you can very easily see that the translocation of IL-6 is almost as efficient as insulin, although it works via a different pathway, because IL-6 didn't phosphorylate AKT, and if you block PI3 kinase activity with wort-mannan, it doesn't affect the translocation of GLUT4 to the membrane. And it so happens that the mechanism is via activation of the fuel-sensing kinase AMP kinase. And so AMP kinase is activated by IL-6 and it increases fat oxidation. You can see here that's the downstream target ACC. So it appears that IL-6 is necessary for metabolic health. And I just would like to share some data from a different group, from Jens Bruning's lab at Cologne, where they now made a floxed IL-6 receptor knockout. And this led to, by doing this, contrary to what was proposed by Michael Caron, to say that it's pro-inflammatory in the liver, it was pro-inflammatory to knock out the signaling pathway because it caused a difference in TNF-alpha. And when TNF-alpha was neutralised, this alteration in metabolic homeostasis was, this is a glucose tolerance test, was rescued. Now, not only is the IL-6 receptor important for metabolism, it's important for macrophages. This is some work we've just done in collaboration with Jens. We had a very small part to play in this. It's their work. But this was a lysemcree IL-6 receptor knockout mouse. The mouse put on a high-fat diet doesn't get any fatter, but it becomes insulin resistant and glucose intolerant. As you can see from all of these, this is, I'll explain this a little bit later, but this is a glucose tolerance test. It's more glucose intolerant. Insulin tolerance test, it's more insulin intolerant. And it has more inflammation in the adipose tissue and greater phosphorylation of junk, as we showed before. Now, the reason why this happened was unapparent, so when you are devoid of ideas, you run a screen. And one of the things we pulled out here was the IL-4 receptor. And when IL-6 is given to the IL-6 receptor, myeloid-specific receptor-deficient animals, the animals don't respond as well in terms of IL-4 signaling. And this is a busy slide, but I'll summarise it for you. When the animals are then treated with LPS, they have a classic pro-inflammatory gene expression profile. And this is due to STAT3. So in this case, an absence of STAT3 signalling polarises macrophages towards an M1 phenotype, and you get classic inflammation. So you have this real conundrum, in summary, whereby if you use, I'll use Actemra, I can never pronounce that word. If you use Actemra, it's really effective in RA, and it may be, you know, effective in treating some of these other diseases where IL-6 has a negative role, but it increases LDL cholesterol, cardiovascular disease, obesity, insulin resistance, and now we know that if you do this, you may be polarising your macrophages towards an inflammatory phenotype. So why is IL-6 so confusing? Well, it's because of its signalling cascade. So classic signalling is where IL-6 will circulate and bind to the receptor to then lead to a homodimerisation of GP130 and a JAK-STAT signalling cascade. But IL-6 can also signal in cells and organs where the IL-6 receptor is barely or not at all expressed. And the way that it does this is in a process called IL-6 transsignaling. And what happens here is that the metalloproteinases atom 10 and atom 17 can cleave the IL-6 receptor and solubilize it. Now, all cells except pre-B cells express GP130. So if you can then, the IL-6 within the circulation can then bind to the IL-6 receptor, and this can lead to the IL-6 receptor, IL-6 complex going to these cells and transducing a signal even though the receptor wasn't expressed in the first place. So the strategy that our colleague Stéphane Rose-Jean at Kiel came up with was to set up a situation where you either inject animals or make a transgenic with a soluble GP130 FC protein. And this acts as a decoy to actually mop up the IL-6 receptor complex, meaning that transsignaling can't occur, but that membrane-bound signalling is still intact because there is still IL-6 unbound to the soluble receptor that then can still transduce a signal in cells where the receptor is expressed to sufficient levels to allow for a signal transduction phenomenon. And so what we did is we tried to see if maybe this transsignaling process was at all involved in chemotaxis in humans. So we took obese, impaired glucose tolerant and obese type 2 diabetic patients, and we compared them to lean healthy controls, and we looked at the expression of one of these metalloproteinases, atom 17, and this is in visceral adipose tissue of these patients. And we also looked at the plasma of these patients and measured the plasma concentration of the soluble IL-6 receptor. And the metalloproteinases were elevated and the soluble IL-6 receptor concentration was elevated. And then we looked at CD68 within the visceral adipose tissue, and it wasn't significantly elevated in this group, but it was in this group. But more importantly, when we did correlations, these were very tight. And particularly, we were particularly interested in this, apart from this person here, there seemed to be a very tight correlation between the expression of CD68 in the white adipose tissue and the soluble IL-6 receptor concentration, suggesting that the soluble IL-6 receptor, that trans-signaling may be a major chemotactic event. And given that I showed you the data that MCIP1 is not the whole story, we decided to look at this a little bit more carefully. So we did a transmembrane macrophage migration assay. We used MCIP1 as your classic control, and you can see a dose response. But we saw pretty much the same response, if not a little bit exacerbated, when we used what was called hyper-IL-6, which is IL-6 linked to the IL-6 receptor by a flexible peptide. But more excitingly is when we then treated this model with the soluble GP130FC, we completely prevented any chemotaxis, any migration of macrophages. And this wasn't a pan effect because it had no effect on the MCIP1 mediated migration and did nothing on its own. So this suggested to us that we'd identified a novel chemotactic event. This is Stefan, and he has made a transgenic mouse, and this mouse is inflammation resistant, at least in one model. These are the concentrations that this is the haploinsufficient animal, this is the transgenic animal, these are the levels of SGP in the plasma of these animals. And this is a study that Stefan published a while ago, but it's interesting in that it's an air pouch model of inflammation, and those who work in inflammation will be familiar with this. You inject a pouch of air at 4 mL at day 3, and then at day 6 you put in carrageenan, which is gelatinous LPS. And in these animals, the SGP130s you would expect is elevated in the pouch, but the interesting thing here is these animals become refractory to migration of immune cells into the pouch. That was very clear. So, of course, putting all of this together was a strong rationale for us studying these animals. And we wanted to study it in the context of this disease. So the first thing we did was phenotype the animals. And I guess in a way analogous to the IL-6 knockouts, these animals have slightly elevated fat mass. Nothing like the IL-6 knockouts who have mega elevated fat mass. But the interesting, and so this is the epididymal fat pad weight. You can see it's a little bit higher. But the interesting thing is that these animals don't have bigger fat pads, adipocytes. They have fewer big adipocytes and more smaller adipocytes. And this is exactly what you want if you are an obese person. In fact, the way the TZDs work, which are now back on market in the US, is to promote adipogenesis so that the adipose tissues, you have more adipose tissue that's smaller rather than larger amounts of bigger adipocytes. And we think this is due to an adipogenic programming, because CBP beta and FABP4, which are two genes known to be involved in adipogenesis, are elevated markedly in the transgenic animals. But the really interesting thing here is that we, by measuring this in several ways, by gene expression of both EMR1 and CD68, by immunohistochemistry and by flow, we pretty much prevent obesity-induced macrophage inflammation. Now, this drug is already registered in two clinical trials. So we got mega excited by these data because we had a drug that seemed to work and we had a drug that had been in man quite a number of times. So if you have a drug that's going to prevent the deleterious effects of obesity, it's a fairly significant clinical finding. And the interesting thing is it couldn't be due to MCIP1. Because the MCIP1 levels were elevated in obesity, but exactly the same, even though there were no macrophages in the adipose tissue, the adipose tissue was equally inflamed. you can see TNF not being any different, nor the phosphorylation of IKK in the adipose tissue. And interestingly, IL-1 beta and NALP3, which I won't talk about, was markedly elevated in these animals that had no macrophages in their adipose tissue, at least in this state. So they really, these data really question the current dogma that MCIP1 pulls macrophages into the adipose tissue and that causes inflammation, because at least our data didn't seem to jive. And when you don't have something that jives, you want to make sure you do it five different ways five times, because if you're wrong, you're in strife. So it really, to us, highlights this complexity. So unlike other studies, we then went and measured some of the other things. And we were able to replicate what was in the literature, in that, you know, CD4 positive cells didn't change in a high-fat diet and CD8 cells go up. We showed that. But this was not blocked by the SGP-130 FC. And we measured a reduction in eosinophils, which people have shown on a high-fat diet. And this wasn't changed by the transgenic. Interestingly, Jerry Olefsky's published a paper showing that neutrophils go up and then release elastase to induce insulin resistance. We measured both the neutrophils and elastase, and in our hands, they go down in high-fat feeding. So we don't know what's going on there, but we've got two independent measures, both the elastase and the flow cytometry, and it's very reasonably clear these go down on a high-fat diet, but they're not different. And so to summarise this part of the talk, transgenic expression of SGP-130 can indeed prevent high-fat diet and use adipose tissue macrophage accumulation, but without affecting the recruitment and or regression of other immune cells. I might add, we're just waiting on the regulatory T-cell data, because we were having problems, and I acknowledge Ajit and Axel for helping us out with working, trying to teach idiot metabolism people how to do immunology. So thanks. The mouse model is less than ideal to test the efficacy of SGP-130 therapy for two reasons. So we didn't even bother testing this metabolically for two reasons. One, since the transgene was expressed from embryogenesis, the accumulation of ATM would have been prevented from the onset of obesity. And you don't start taking a drug when you're in the womb or when you're 1 year old, or indeed when you're 10, in the hope that you're going to prevent obesity when you're 50. You get obese and then you go to the doctor. And the other thing was, because we had this adipogenesis phenotype, it rendered our model a complicated model. So we went and we did a clinical intervention trial in a mouse. We had four groups of mice. Two were controls, chow and high-fat diet, and then two further high-fat diet groups that we kept going for another 6 weeks, and one group was treated with SGP-130 FC injections and the other saline. And in this case, what we showed was that this time it was a clean model. The treatment didn't affect adipocyte size, number, anything. All that happened is that the fat mass went up and the body mass went up on the high-fat diet independent of treatment. You can see here there's the fat pad weights and there's the adipocyte number. So these animals, it wasn't the complicated model we had with the transgenic. But what we showed was that, again, we were able to almost prevent or largely reduce the macrophage accumulation in adipose tissue. So this time we went and we did complex metabolic measures. And in our lab, we use a really neat way of measuring metabolic homeostasis in the mouse. We can get a lot of information from this. And it's the euglycemic hyperinsulinemic clamp, I could never do this because you have to have the patience to catheterise the jugular vein and sometimes the carotid artery and then exteriorise the catheters through the back of the neck so the mouse doesn't pick at them, the mouse then recovers and we can do a conscious clamp as you can do in humans. Now, a clamp is the following. You have your catheter here and you can infuse a tracer of glucose, you infuse insulin and you infuse glucose. And what you do is you infuse insulin at a hyperinsulinemic dose and you maintain euglycemia by adjusting the variability of the glucose pump. So the more glucose you have to infuse, the more insulin sensitive your animal, the healthier your animal. And then we can measure basal and clamp liver glucose production. We can measure glucose disappearance. And we can also infuse another tracer, which we infuse 2-deoxyglucose uptake, which is taken up and trapped and not metabolized, to measure tissue glucose uptake. And unfortunately, this was a resounding failure, unhappily. But it is what it is. You can see here that despite the fact these animals had almost a disappearance of macrophages and drug companies have been chasing this for many, many years, the animal wasn't improved at all in terms of GIR, GDR, which is glucose disposal rate, or the percent suppression of hepatic glucose production by insulin. And so we thought maybe that the systemic insulin sensitivity was being overwhelmed by other factors, but it didn't even affect visceral or subcutaneous RG prime, which is glucose uptake. So even in the adipose tissue itself, there wasn't a local improvement of insulin sensitivity. It just was an absolute resounding failure. So the results from our drug intervention study clearly demonstrated that more than a twofold regression in adipose tissue macrophages at the onset of obesity had no effect on high-fat diet-induced insulin resistance. Now, in this study, unlike the SGP-130 transgenic mice, the high-fat diet-induced ATM accumulation was not completely prevented. So you could say, all right, maybe if you titer the dose so that you can prevent it completely, you may get improvement. So we went and studied a final cohort of animals. And this time we took our SGP-130 mice, but what we did in this is we carefully matched them. So the ones that were very, very, had very, very low adiposity in the wild types, we chucked out. And the ones that had very, very high adiposity in the transgenics, we chucked out. So we carefully matched the mice for body mass and fat mass to remove the differences which could potentially account for the phenotype. And you can see here we did that successfully. Body mass wasn't different, fat mass wasn't different. But this time again, we prevented just gene expression, but we also did the immunohistochemistry and we've pretty much prevented, as we did in the first study, macrophage accumulation. And no cigar there either. No improvement at all. No improvement in the visceral, subcutaneous or brown adipose tissue glucose uptake. So we can only conclude that the soluble IL-6 receptor is a potent chemotactic signal for macrophage migration. And this may be important for many, many diseases. And remember, it's not all doom and gloom, because by targeting this, we have a metabolically healthy mouse whereby knocking out either the ligand or the receptor, we have a metabolically sick mouse. So it is a better strategy for inflammatory diseases. And I think this would turn out to be a much better drug than Actemra for RA, because you won't get those associated side effects. At least that's the prediction. But you saw where our last prediction went. Blocking IL-6 transsignaling prevents the accumulation of macrophages. So we really think this is the impetus for future work in inflammatory diseases. But whether targeting macrophage accumulation is an effective therapeutic strategy to rescue insulin resistance in a setting of obesity is questionable based on our preclinical data. So we come back to this diagram, which you've seen a few times, and really it highlights the importance of the whole immunological milieu. And it's best summarised by Diane Mathis, who I hope may see our paper one day, because this is the garden of earthly delights, which some of you may have seen. And this is her conclusion in one of her reviews. The complex cast of cellular characters implicated in obesity-associated inflammation and attendant metabolic abnormalities in their diverse activities are difficult for one, she's talking about macrophages, especially one on the metabolism side of immunometabolism, to assimilate. The goings-on in this painting spring to mind what is the root of the complexity. So to summarise, really, to think simplistically that you can just block macrophage chemotaxis for a complex disease like obesity, I mean, when I thought about it, I should have almost thought this was doomed to failure. But anyway, the data are what they are. So I really want to acknowledge the people who did the work, particularly Michael Crackman, who that was all of the data I showed you there was part of his PhD. He's been just a truck and a good bloke, which is more important than being a truck. And past members in my lab, my overseas collaborators, particularly Stefan, who, I mean, it's really good working with a biochemist because he thinks all the cool stuff is in making the animals, and I think all the cool stuff is in testing them in diseases. And my local collaborators, and Axel and Agis, who are helping us out here, people at the Baker and David James's group at the Garvan, and of course, the people who put food on my table and my postdoc's table, and may it continue. Thanks very much. Oh, and just one other thing. For those of you who are interested in there's a couple of reviews that we've recently written that you might want to think about reading if you're interested in this stuff. And thanks for your attention.
So you relate your study to macrophage recruitment by using the CD11C-DTR transgene mice, right? But the CD11C is expressed on the dendritic cells as well?
Yeah, the CD11C cells wasn't our study. Yeah. And I think one of the major problems with that as well is the dendritic cells. But, you know, the role of the dendritic cells in the etiology of metabolic diseases, I'm sure groups have worked on this and trying to locate the contribution of the dendritic cells, and you know it's even another level of complexity. But I agree that targeting CD11Cs has the complicated facet of the dendritic cells.
In your treatment of JP130, so if you add some T cell treatment, would you prevent the insulin
resistance? So what was the question again, sorry?
So if you treat the immune T cells, like.
So see, this is the thing. So if you could treat, say, use a CD8 inhibitor or something that blocks CD8, right? Then you've got to then get a drug. Then you've got to add IL-33. To maintain the Tregs and make sure they don't go away. Then you've got to get a drug to prevent neutrophils, and then you've got to get a drug to prevent eosinophils leaving. So I take your point, but if you just do one by one by one, it's going to be a, let's call it a poly pill. It's going to be a fairly complex drug.
What's your solution?
My solution is for metabolic disease. Pharmacologically, don't target the inflammation, target the lipid accretion. And one of the things we've shown in my lab and others is that liver fat is the root to all evil. both in humans and animals. And so we now working on therapeutics, a whole different story that targets liver steatosis. So that's my two bobs worth. I'm not a drug design chemist or a big pharma person, but that's what I do.
So, as you said that, have you tried to treat your mice treat with the high fat diet induced mice with the soluble GLP-1 L6 receptor and the drug I mentioned increase the lipogenesis?
Have we tried to combine?
Yeah, no. Sort of like increase the fat dog and baby mama.
No, we haven't tried that. We haven't. I suspect that. Well, I don't know until we do the experiment. But I mean, the GP130 on its own didn't have an effect, so I'm unsure how you would have it. How you would have either synergy.
Sorry, the soluble
IL-6
receptor.
The soluble IL-6 receptor knockout. Have we treated them with the drug?
Yeah.
No, because we don't have them. The soluble IL-6 receptor knockouts, the work was done in Germany, but I am getting them and we do intend on using them for doing some of these experiments. So we haven't done those experiments, but intend to if we can.
You say IL-6 trans signaling pathway is responsible for the chemotactic
value
inflammation?
I didn't say inflammation. I said the chemotactic event in drawing macrophages into adipose tissue.
So how well is this pathway being characterized, say, for example, the downstream signaling event? What's the difference between
With classical signaling?
Yep.
So the difference is not in the downstream signaling event. The difference is in the specificity of the cellular response to an insult. So I'll explain. If you have complete blockade of IL-6 signal transduction, you will block IL-6 signaling in pretty much every cell except a pre-B cell. Because a BAF3 cell, to my knowledge, is the only cell that doesn't express SGP-130, right? But if you block trans signaling, you then specifically block the response in cells that don't express the IL-6 receptor. So in one scenario, you block everything. In the second scenario, you're only blocking the signal in cells that don't express that receptor. So in cells that express the IL-6 receptor, IL-6 trans signaling will not occur, but IL-6 membrane signaling will occur, presumably, if you have IL-6 in the circulation.
So has anyone looked at what cells doesn't have the IL-6
receptor? Yes, there's conjecture over this. But the adipocytes, for example, don't really express the IL-6 receptor. The other thing is, this drug has also been trialled for atherosclerotic lesions. There's a paper by a German group as well that used it in the context of foam cell development in atherosclerosis, and in that, at least in mouse models, it had efficacy. So I'm not saying it doesn't work to prevent inflammation. There are now two papers that show that. It isn't effective in changing metabolic homeostasis in obese models.
Okay, so one last question.
Just a quick one, Mark. That clinical slide you showed about the anti-IL-6 effects on metabolism, lipid profile, where you showed cholesterol go up and BMI went up. HDL also went up. How do you explain that?
Well, I mean, I can't explain an increase in HDL, and I'm not a clinician. I'd be more worried about the fact that weight gain goes up, and I've had clinicians call me.
Sure, but it's an interesting observation. Because yeah. Whenever you see weight go up, HDL goes down. So
yeah.
There's something.
But HDL didn't go up much, John.
It went up significantly.
A little bit.
What I'm saying is that actually this is potentially providing an insight of what the hell's happened. That's
yeah,
and there's something that's a paradoxical effect, and And that must be telling you something about what it's doing, presumably at the liver.
Yeah, I take that point. I take that point, but I'm more, I guess, I mean, who knows if cholesterol is even important for disease? Some people say it is, some people say, you know, the HDL drug raising trials. Yeah, okay, I agree with you. But I tell you what's a little bit more alarming, John, is the weight gain. And I don't think you should be promoting obesity. No, I'm not saying you are. I'm saying I don't think we should be promoting, I don't think therapeutics. Although, if a therapy is going to make you fatter but keep you alive, I'm all for it. But if it's going to make you fatter and cause greater disease, it's probably best to look at tweaking the system a bit. And that's why I think the SGP-130 may be a good drug to target for RA, but what the hell do I know about RA?
All right, I think we should leave it there in the interest of time. Please, it's going to be thank you, Mark.